In St. Paul. Thank you so much for joining us here this evening. You feeling good?
To be tonight. Suddenly in this world,
she said. Looking up from a cigarette, she's all in. How's it going this evening? You feeling good? Yeah. Just what I have you, I just want to say a huge thank you, if I could, to the incredible artist that is Alison Russell. Can I hear it for Alison Russell? Yeah. It's such a joy sharing these shows with Alison and her amazing band, you know? I'm gonna level with you this evening. I just want to say thank you for being such a wonderful audience for Alison Russell. It's so great to be here. It's so great to play this room. This is absolutely crazy. And I absolutely hate leveling with you like this, but we had a virus that was kind of running through the band the last few days, and I was fine. I was absolutely flying, and I was kind of pushing through a few shows, and it sort of caught up with me tonight. Shut up and sing. I'm just kidding. But I hate saying that, and I hate, so there might be some songs that I might need some extra help on, either from myself or. Thanks so much. And there's a few songs we were gonna maybe have in the set, and I feel like I'll just make shit of them if I try them. So but we're gonna give you a hell of a show that we can, you know what I mean? But I just wanna say, if you're up for lending your kind of lungs and your throats for one or two numbers, I would so appreciate them. So. How are you guys doing up top? You feeling good? It's absolutely crazy being in this space. Thank you so much for coming, everybody. Thank you.
Joining the wretched and joyful, shaking the wind.
This man's still alive. The song is about two people who aren't. It's called Francesca. To think I'd give up, and this might have shut the love from me. But I was on the brink. How could you think, darling, let's get so much. We're in business. Thank you. This is also about somebody who's not alive anymore, or maybe who was never alive, but it's just fun to imagine that he was, you know. Yeah. It's not fun to imagine, who imagines it dead? If you're familiar with that old Greek story of a father who pushes his kid off a cliff and says, "Put on these wings there like a good lad, you're gonna be fine." This is kind of a love song that sort of imagines that, you know, the act of falling is so spectacular that he was couldn't be convinced that he died on the other side of that, you know. It's a song called I Carry.
If the wind turns, if I hear a squall, allow the ground to find its brutal way to me. I feel lighter than I have in so much time. I've crossed the borderline of weightless and deep breath out from the sky. I've reached the river height now that I can't confirm. All our weight is just a burden offered to us by the world. And though it burns, how could I fall when I am lifted by every word you say to me? If anything could fall at all, it's the world that falls away from me. You have me floating like a feather on the sea. While you are as heavy as the world that you hold your hands beneath. Once I had wondered what was holding up the ground. I can see it all alone, Lord. It was you all the way down. Leaving now, I am skybound. To dine in your way to me. We'll float away, but if we fall, I only pray, don't fall away from me. I do not have wings, but I never.
Cello by the very, very wonderful Kenneth Memrick. And the very, very wonderful Larissa Meister. This next song is one I wrote years ago, and it was, I just put it on the last EP. Well, no, not this EP, last EP, before that. What year is it? Where are we? And it's a song I wrote. I'm just going to presence for one moment, and then we're just going to move on from remembering what the pandemic was like. Okay, we're done. And so I was living alone in County Wicklow in the countryside, and just that period of sort of distance between people and awayness, and that sense of just wanted to do something, that powerlessness type thing. And I was, I've been in the countryside. What you're going to hear is this recording of this absolute Hitchcock hour of birds, which happened a few times a day. I just recorded it. But it was a special song for me, and then it's the first of my own music that I got to share with the incredible artist and inspiration that is Alison Russell. Please welcome to the stage, Alison Russell, please. And so, oh, that's so cool. And then, thank you so much. And then, what was I gonna say? So, myself and Alison Russell met at Newport Folk Festival a few years ago, and I've been friends ever since, and Alison is one of the great freedom singers of our generation, I think, and of our time. She's been a dear friend and an inspiration. Around that time that we sang this song together, she was gracious enough to invite me onto her beautiful song Requiem from her Grammy-winning album, The Returner, which our very own Larissa Maestro also worked on arranging string music. But this is a song called Wildflower and Barley.
Springtime in the country, each time I'm shocked by the light, the world lying fallow, and you are apart from everything in my vision. Is movement and light, riverboat, wheelbarrow, wildflower and barley. Springtime in the country, I can smell summer on its bed. Oh, a narrow life feels in the heart of me. Everything in my vision, departure and death, riverboat, wheelbarrow, wildflower and barley. This year I swear it will be the reading nation. This year I swear it will be the reading world. So close to the surface, so close to the past, useful to stir, put my body.
Alison Russell, again, I'm gonna level with you. I actually miscalled the song, and Alison, in her wonderful readiness, was there. So thank you so much, Alison. You're an absolute wonder. Thank you so much. This is an older one. If you know it, I'd love to hear you with us. Mm-hmm. I went to a Catholic school, but you'd be surprised. Yeah. Before we go into this next song, do you guys want to hear a funny story? And this is, I don't do this just to buy time, but I do this just to buy time. And honestly, I don't know why, I feel like you're getting a very different sort of, I feel very naked up here. I feel like you're seeing a very raw version of, not in that way, but just like, you know. And so this is a story that like, of kind of in the next song that we're gonna play, and where the line sort of came from, and I just think it's kind of funny, and I haven't really said it all that much. I probably would go to my grave without saying it, but it's kind of a good story, and I'd rather it come from me. But like, it was just one of those nights where you haven't seen your friend for a very, very long time, and I had a flight to Los Angeles the next day from Wicklow. It was in County Wicklow in Ireland, to finish the album, and it was kind of doing the last sessions of the record, and there was one song that was yet to be finished, and I sort of was struggling to write a few lines for it. Not struggling, but just, I was in the process of writing it, and it's just one of those nights, like, where you haven't seen one of your best old mates, a friend I've known since I was 12, and he had work in the morning. It was a Thursday, and I remember because I had a flight Friday morning, and I was to be collected at 10 o'clock, and I hadn't started packing by the time we had our first drinks, and he had work the next morning. He had to be in at 10 o'clock. But it was one of those nights where you look at the clock and you're like, oh, Jesus, man, it's 3 o'clock, we have to go to bed. And you're already half cut, and you know, you end up, just you know, one more type thing. And I won't go into it, but anyway, kind of fast forward, and then it's like 5 o'clock. Like, you just blink and it's 5:30. And so we go to bed and we think we have convinced ourselves, and we're just like, smoking cigarettes and drinking very heavily all night, and we go to bed as you do, and so I wake up to the sight of him standing over my bed, being like, "Dude, I'm late for work now, and you need to get up. There's a car arriving for you to bring you to the airport in like 30 minutes. I haven't started packing at this point." And he needed to get out of the gate, and I had the code to kind of let him out of the house, and I could live in the countryside. And so he was in a panic. So I get up thinking I'm fine. And I sort of, you know, before the hangover sets in, you think you're okay, but it's like you're still drunk. And he was definitely in that sort of state. And I'm sitting on the stairs watching him put his shoes on. Like, that was great crack, man. It was so much fun. Great to catch up, you know. And he's like, "Yeah, cool." And I stand up. Now, this is the thing. I don't know if there's many tall, very, very tall gentlemen in the house, or tall women as well, too. This effect. The first time this happened to me, I was a college student. I was drinking very heavily. And I stood up too quickly. And if you have a hangover, your blood pressure is very, very low. And if you do that too quickly, your blood pressure is low, it doesn't get to your brain in time. And so you could just hit the deck. There's nothing wrong with you. You just need to chill out for a second and let the blood hit your brain. So I stand up anyway, and I'm like, I'm about to go to the restroom. It's up, something like that. He's putting on the shoes. I get up, and then, you know, blindness, bam. And I'm walking at full pace, and I am quite tall. Like, it's been said to me, if I fell down, I would be halfway home. But I was walking like at a full pace, and I just like, boom, like went like this. And my head hit this glass pane. I hope no one's recording this. Of course they are. And my head hit the window at such force, right? And I hit the deck. This is a long story, by the way. It gets really... So my head, I'm going to put this down. My head hit the window, and I've started now, so I'm going to finish. My head hit the window at such force, and then I just hit the deck, and I was like, you know what? And you have that moment where you're like, you know what, actually, fine. I'm just going to rest here. The ground is cold, and you feel like that's bringing life back into your body, you know? You feel like you're like, And my friend started having an absolute panic. He thought like, just the way that my neck moved when I hit the thing. He was like, "Dude, no, something's wrong." And in his state, he was like, "I have to move you. I have to get you up. This doesn't look right." I was like, "No, man, keep me here. And so we have this back and forth. I'm on the ground. And he's like, "No, come on, get up, get in that kitchen." I'm like, "Cool, yeah." Hit the deck again, right? Straight into a wall. And then I pack. Then I convince him that I'm okay. He goes to work. I pack, and my back is in like horrendous spasm and stuff like that. I'm in like rough shape, going through security, through the onto the plane, grand, fine, all good, and I'm like rattled, like, you know, that kind of like that type of hangover where you're shaking and your back is a bit. And I look over to the left of me on this plane, and I see a famous Irish actor, and I'm like, oh my God. And I'm like, I'm also subject to like celebrity shock, where you see somebody you've seen on screen a thousand times, and you're like, oh my God, that's a famous person, like, you know, that's like, you know, when I see Cillian Murphy is to my left. And the thing is, I was like, oh my God, and he's there, and he's just chilling. He's on the way to finish audio for a film. And I haven't said hi to him, I haven't spotted him, I've never met Cillian Murphy. He's a celebrity to me, somebody I'm a huge fan of. And then, and I'm like, okay, cool, stop staring. I have that thing where I'm like, oh no, my God, it's Cillian Murphy. I'm like, stop staring, just chill out. And I'm wearing a beanie all that morning. I was wearing a hat. And I was on the plane midway through this flight. We'd taken off about 40 minutes later. We'd been in the air about 40 minutes. And I kind of like scratching at my head, going like, that's where the impact was. And I'm like, oh my God, that's wet. And so I'm like, on a plane, looking at my fingers going, oh Jesus Christ, I'm bleeding a little bit. And I don't know the extent of the head wound. I don't know how bad it is. And so like, I'm just pale and I'm like, oh my God, this could be quite bad. I'm trying to keep it together and like, and I also can't see it, you know, so. And then just at that moment, I kind of looked to my left and for context, I had written a thing for UNICEF that was curated by Cillian Murphy. I'd written it months ago, but I'd never met him, but he put together this beautiful collection of essays on empathy for UNICEF. And I had contributed, it was loads of Irish contributors, the Irish president and political figures and creatives and stuff like that. Stories on empathy. So I had only had like one email exchange, maybe that had kind of gone through other people, and it was just about this thing that was quite official and quite like, you know, and I turned to my left, and then just as I'm like realizing that my head is like bleeding to some extent, I'm like, okay, how do I figure out? Am I going to go to the bathroom and like film this wound or something? I can't turn to like an air hostess and be like, listen, I might be in trouble here. And I turn to my left and Cillian Murphy is like hunkered by my seat. He's like, man, how's it going? I just want to say thank you so much for contributing that thing yesterday on empathy. That was so, so sweet. And I was like, oh, thanks. Yeah, and I'm trying to like play it cool. I'm definitely not like freaking out of my nut here, like, but thank you so, so much. And he was so sweet and so kind. But the that event, now I really haven't burnt the candle like that since then, as much as I, you know, maybe now and then, but like that was one of these sort of, and it lives in infamy among my friend group, but it's where the line, I aim low, I aim true, and the ground is where I go as well. I've never told Cillian Murphy that, I've never met him since, and I didn't have the guts to tell him the time and shape that I was in. So don't, nobody share this on social media or anything. I feel quite a few just keep that between us. Okay.
very much. Hidden Story was like twice as long as the song.
Oh my god.
I'm not afraid to
actually to pretty much everybody here on stage by two very, very wonderful people in that last number. Joining me from the Bahamas via New York City on synth and percussion and vocals. Please put your hands together for the incredible Camila. Joining me from New York City on synth and percussion and vocals. Please put your hands together. The incredible Melissa McMillan.
Take me to church, I worship like a dog, and I'm trying to get loose.
sincerely, I was kind of like dreading coming out here tonight. I won't lie, I was in rough shape. So thank you for being so sweet and just taking it. Taking me as you have found me this evening. Thank you so much, sincerely. I just want to say I feel blessed to be able to do this night after night and to be met with audiences like you and welcomes like this. So thank you so much. It really is no small thing, especially these days, I think, to spend your hard-earned money on anything and anything like this or any sort of thing that is of the arts. And so I so appreciate that you choose this show. Which is also why I'm dreading coming out and not giving my best. So thank you so much for just being so wonderful. First songs I ever released, and if you know what, I'd love to hear you with me.
Thank you.
song with the hero of mine, the legend that is Mavis Staples. And I wanted to write this song to remind myself of the small ways that people contribute to each other's lives around them, you know. Yeah. Small little acts of love and solidarity which on the hard days seem to hold the world together. All of us, in our own little ways, we maybe turn to people in our lives, our family and friends. We say, hey, I see what you're going through, and I can see that, and I'm here for you, you know. And in so many ways, for our community, you know, in ways that are sometimes beneath notice, we recognize the experience of other human beings, and we show up for them, you know. I think that's a big, big part of living in a democracy, you know. And I also wrote this to remind myself of everything that we have to be thankful for with regards to protest, everything the protest has given us. And it's something that, depending on who you're talking to, they can roll their eyes at it and it can be much vilified. But there's so much that in our respective democracies that we enjoy every single day that people have to push for, protest for, and organize for, you know. Just talking about the right to vote, I'm not just talking about every single citizen having the right to vote, which we take for granted, something that was not the case in living memory. I'm not just talking about women having the right to vote. I'm not even just talking about the simple things like having a weekend to look forward to, something that the labor movement had to push very, very hard for. But the fact that women have control over their reproductive systems and full reproductive rights. It's so easy to take for granted, but it's so, so easy for it to be taken away, and it's something that my country only achieved in 2018, and no politician would offer a word to that issue until people started getting out on the streets and really, you know, started organizing grassroots movements. We take for granted that members of the LGBTQ plus community should have the rights, same rights that we enjoy. Something that took a lot of people also recognizing the experience of their neighbors, recognizing the experience of their kids, of their parents, of their siblings, and saying, your experience may be different from mine, but I would want you to feel as safe and secure in this society as I feel, you know. These things, I think, are so important, they're so simple. As I said, I recorded this with Mavis Staples, who used to sing before speeches during the American Civil Rights Movement here, you know. Why that was of some interest to me as an Irishman, I don't know if there's anybody here with Irish heritage or Irish lineage. But something that bears repeating is that civil rights movement that happened here in the 60s directly inspired a civil rights movement that happened very shortly afterwards in Northern Ireland. At a time and place where not every single citizen in Northern Ireland was guaranteed the right to vote, you know? We've been singing this song in solidarity with anybody who engage that same empathy and that same compassion in bearing witness to the lived experience of people on the other side of the world. And reaching out to their representatives and saying we wouldn't want to see any human being subject to the kind of violence that we're seeing in Gaza over these last moments. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter where you're from in the world. It doesn't matter if you're an Israeli citizen or a Palestinian citizen. No human being should be subject to that kind of violence. That kind of discriminatory violence. Said I come from Ireland, and the peace process that brought centuries of occupation and occupational violence to a close had huge involvement from the US administration at the time, huge involvement from US citizens at the time. So I'm speaking from that place, that if you feel moved to reach out to your representatives and ask them to support the ceasefire, meaningfully support a ceasefire and a peaceful political solution, these things can really make a difference, and it can really make a difference to let politicians know which way the wind is blowing, you know what I mean? Speak from that place of compassion, and seeing safety and security and peace for everybody in that region would of course see a Palestine free from occupation. It would mean seeing a Palestine free from occupational violence, perpetual occupation, you know? So I want to thank you for letting me speak out from the heart. I know I've talked a lot tonight for God's sake, but thank you so much. And thank you. thank you for letting me witness the kind of goodwill and that kind of solidarity and that kind of goodness that I see in a night like tonight. People coming together in goodwill and love to enjoy music together. Thank you so, so much. Thank you so much.
It's not the waking, it's the light. It is the grounding of a foot I'm compromising. It's not forgoing of a light. It's not the opening of a light. It's not the waking, it's the rising. It's not the shade we should rest in. It's the light and it's the obstacle we cast. The drives of light, it's the fire ignites. It's not the waking, it's the rising. It's not the song, it is the singing. It's the hearing of a human spirit ringing. It is the bringing of a light. It is the bearing of a rain. It's not the waking, it's the rising.
One more time to this incredible band of musicians. Joining me from Nashville, Tennessee, on keys and organ and vocoder and conga and vocals. Please make some noise for the incredible Ryan. Ryan Collins. Joining me also from Nashville, Tennessee, on violin and guitar and vocals. Please put your hands together for the incredible Kellen Wenrick. Joining me from New York City on synth and percussion and keys and vocals. Please put your hands together for the incredible Joy Morales. Joined from Nashville, Tennessee, on cello and guitar and mandocello and birdsong and human song. The incredible Larissa Maestro. Joining me from the Bahamas via New York City on synth and percussion and vocals, please make some noise for the incredible Camila. Joining me from New York City on synth and percussion and vocals, please make some noise one more time for the incredible Melissa McMillan. I'm joined from County Kerry in Ireland on synth and bass and vocals. Please make some noise for the MD of this group, Mr. Alex Ryan. And joining me from Dublin, Ireland, on drums and percussion and vocals, please make some noise for the indelible, incredible Dr. Rory Doyle. He is a practicing, unlicensed doctor. He'll be signing scripts on the way out. You can legally, we're not doing that. I want to say a huge thank you to all of our incredible crew. Thank you so much to Stephen Patterson, front of house engineer. Mixing this gig, thank you so much, Stephen Patterson. Joseph E.I. Morris, our lighting engineer. Thank you so much, Joseph. My incredible guitar technician, Mark Murphy. Thank you, Mark. Incredible bass and drum technician, Fred Burke. Thank you, Fred. Incredible guitar, string, backline, and keys tech, Mark Ryan. Thank you so much, Mark. Thank you to our incredible monitor engineer, Hunter Scoggins. Thank you, Hunter. Thank you to Nick Sage on audio. Thank you to Carson on audio at front, and Shane here, side stage on audio. Thank you. Thank you all. I say a huge thank you to Duchess Iredale, our tour manager, Shelby Kushner, our band manager, Nick Laurie, our production manager, Sinead Madden, our production assistant. Thank you so much. Ray Wasellick, our stage manager. Thank you, Ray. Thanks so much to Colleen Wittenberg, who's directing these screens, keeping us visible. As are Paul and Freddie, our wonderful camera team. Thank you so much. Our wonderful photographer, Ruth Menchberg. Thank you very, very much, Ruth. And Rob, our head of security, keeping an eye out for everybody. Thank you so much, Rob. I want to say a huge thank you to our carpenters, Michael and Shivers. Thank you both. To our crew boss, Kitty Hoffman. Thank you so much, Kitty, and Kevin Byatt also on lights. I want to say a huge thank you also to Dana on the merch table. Sincerely on the merch table, thank you so much, Dana, up front. And if I could, I just want to say one final thank you. And if I can hear an enormous round of applause, please join me in welcoming to the stage for this last number, the incredible Alison Russell!
From the cherry tree, it's my baby, sweet.